Unified Beer. BR. You can get a 4+2 degree, which is a 4-year bachelor's of science in architecture, and then a master's degree in architecture. Commonly referred to as 4+2. You end up with a master's of arch. Or you can get a doctorate of architecture, typically takes 7 years. It's called a DArch, it's not a PhD. Right, so there's three different ways to get there. It depends on the university you happen to be taking to. These are all accredited by what body? No. AIA is a membership organization. They are all accredited by NAB, the National Accreditation Architecture Board, something like that. NAB. You want to make sure you have a NAB accredited degree. Does CSN offer a NAB accredited degree?
Guessing not.
No, because we don't fit in any of these categories, do we? The only NAB accredited degree in the state of Nevada is UNLV. And it's their master's that's accredited. So you got to get a bachelor's before you can even start to talk about an accredited degree. Once you have an accredited degree, you can start your internship. Well, the next step is internship. Some hours you can get earlier, and they've moved that threshold down quite a bit. When I was doing it, it was after your third year of architecture school. Now I think it's right out of high school, you can start accumulating some hours. But you have to report those hours every 6 months. So you have to have a record with NCARB. You need an NCARB record. And you report your time. It's 3,000 some odd hours. It typically takes about 3 years. Realizing that, how many hours do you typically work in a year? 2,000 hours, right? 2,080 hours, actually. But basically, 2,000 hours a year is what a full-time employee would work. So you're looking at about 3 years for your experience. Examination, you have to take a 7-part exam. Covers all sorts of stuff. Covers everything that's covered here, basically, and everything that's covered here, and then some. So it's a 7-part exam. It used to be 9 parts. I think they're actually trying to go to 5 parts, but it's all basically the same information. It's called the Architectural Registration Exam, or the ARE. I believe they're version 5.0 right now. That will most likely change before you ever take your exam. It changes every couple of years. When I took it, it was 9 parts. And it was ARE 3.0. Same exam, just 9 parts. Exam fees run you about $1,000, plus or minus. It is very rare that you pass all the exams on the first try. For example, I passed 8 out of 9 the first time, and that was, I don't want to say unheard of, but most of my peers failed the exams multiple times. I think the pass rate's about 60%. So when you add up all of these, how long do you think it takes the average architect to get registered?
7
minutes.
Minimum 8.
Yeah, minimum of 8, that would be really, really fast. It's somewhere around 12 to 15 years is what the average is. The time you start architecture school to the time that you are a registered architect. All right, so not a long-term commitment, right? Really, all of these things are a long-term commitment. So why would you want to do this?
I'm going to live them anyway.
Because I'm going to live them anyway. I guess that's a good, don't have anything to rebut that. But hopefully you're going to live the years anyway. It's a major investment, right? What does the average architect make coming out of school, or architectural intern make?
60 to 40.
Way closer to 40. What's the average architect make once they're registered?
I'd rather pretty much say, realistic, if you're not really famous, to be like a teacher salary.
Oh, I don't know about that. Architects typically make more than teachers.
No, I read it in the book.
Okay, well, more than Clark County School District teachers by far. Yeah, you're probably looking, coming out of school at this point as an architect, probably looking at $45,000 a year in Las Vegas, plus or minus. more for some firms, less for other firms. When you're registered, you actually pass all this. $75,000 a year is not uncommon. Is that a lot of money? How many of you think that's a lot of money? For the amount of time you're actually going to work and put into it, you don't get paid what you're worth. I'll tell you that right now. And $75,000 might sound like a lot of money. You're like, oh, I can have nice things. But you're typically working 60 hours plus a week. And then you look at the requirements it takes to get here. This is what it takes for a doctor to become a doctor.
Yeah.
So we're here as a doctor, but not as native.
Yeah. Now you got to joke about that. So a doctor and an architect go to lunch. That joke hasn't started yet, but I'm glad you find it. Doctor and architect go to lunch. Doctor says, you know, they're talking about compensation. Doctor says, hey, well, I gotta go to school for 6 years. Minimum. Architect says, I do too. Well, then I gotta do my residency for 3 years, at least. Architect says, I do too. Doctor says, well, I gotta take all these medical board exams. Architect says, well, I gotta take exams too. Doctor says, yeah, but if I screw up, people die. Architect says, yeah, one at a time. So, do you get compensated for the value you actually bring to the world? I, as an architect, would argue no, but this is the reality, right? Can you make more money than this? Absolutely, you can make more money than that. Depends on where you position yourself in the industry. But don't think that you're going to get out of architecture school and all of a sudden somebody's going to slap $150,000 a year in your hand and be like, oh, here, come design my museum, come design my house, come design my... It's not going to happen. It's not. And you know, interior designers make a little bit less than architects, and residential designers obviously make a little bit less than interior designers, just based on the fact of what does it take to become that person. Now, can you have a fulfilling career as a residential designer? Yeah. One of the architects that works with the school district, he's a residential designer. I can't tell you the last time he did a residential building. He works on schools. But he has partners that are architects that, you know, oversee that work as well. So you can have a very fulfilling career. Do you have to get registered to have a career in these industries? No, you do not have to. Would I advocate that you go get registered? Absolutely, it gives you more options. But no, you don't have to get registered. You can go out there, you can be a draftsman, you can be a project manager. If you want to own your own practice, your easiest route is to get registered as one of these three disciplines. But no, you do not have to get registered before you can start contributing to this industry. In fact, I would say that in most firms, probably 10 to 20% of the people working in the firm are actually registered design professionals. Everybody else is either in that process or has decided that that process is not for them.
So do you generally, like if you're working in a firm, would you make more money if you were registered versus someone that's not registered? Like,
you would think, huh?
Firm, like, well, that has more valuable.
You get a small bump, but it's not like I'm making twice what somebody else is making who is not registered.
Right. Kind of like when you have your master's as a teacher.
Yeah, exactly. You get a small bump.
Does the information change drastically, or most of the exam the same thing that's been covered for the last 60 years?
The exams are updated on a regular basis. The foundation of the exam is essentially the same, but new technology arises, those things are covered in the exam. So the exam I took 8 or 9 years ago is not going to be the exam that you take in 8 or 9 years from now. Just to say it'll cover the same basic information, but it will have evolved.
Can you do a mixture of residential and interior? Can you decide one first?
Absolutely. There are, my wife is considered going back and getting a master's in architecture. She has a bachelor's in interior design, but she's registered. frankly makes more money than I do, so probably would never do that. But yes, yeah, so you can study multiple different disciplines. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
I don't know if this is with this field. Like with other fields, you can go and get a minor. Is there like minors for like architecture? Or is that?
I know people have gotten minors in construction management, minors in art, but there are related fields that you could get a minor in. But of course, that's above and beyond your architecture studies. Wouldn't hurt you. Yes, sir.
It's probably going off that field. If I wanted to be a professor of architecture, is there a route to that?
It depends on where you want to teach.
University level?
So, you absolutely need a master's degree if you're going to teach, but if you really want to make a career out of teaching, you want to consider going to get a post-professional or a doctorate degree. And in architecture, that's kind of, there's two types of doctorates. There's theory-based doctorates, which you receive your PhD, like in architectural theory or architectural history, urbanism, things of that nature. And then there's more practical doctorates or professional doctorates where you would get a DArch. Those are geared more towards the profession and not viewed in the same light in academia. But typically people who are really good at architecture school end up getting hired on to be graduate assistants, and some of those people get vectored into being teachers. Then it becomes more important where you go and get your master's degree. If you want to teach at a university, you might want to look at an Ivy League school for your master's degree. Design a single family house. Essentially, they work on single family homes. When in addition to your house, you go to a residential designer. You want a custom house, typically you're going to go to a residential designer depending on how complex the custom house is. There's some residential designers here in Vegas, all they do is $1 million homes. Interior designer, they can do everything from residential projects to commercial hospitality projects. So most of the stuff on the strip is led by an interior designer. Restaurants, nightclubs, interior spaces, right? The focus on the interior space. Maybe one of the only places in the world where the interior designer oftentimes has more control than the architect.
Do they also run we used to hire companies that come in for special events and help with the decor of the, you know, to change the ballroom into whatever.
I know some people who have gone into that, like event planning, but it doesn't require you to be registered.
Okay. I'm just curious how.
I know some people who have gone into that industry, but there's a lot of different ways to get into that industry that don't involve all the education that is required to become an interior designer. Does this clarify these routes for you guys? Yes, sir.
So how does someone become Frank Gehry, kind of that level?
Luck? luck and a lot of hard work, right? So Frank Gehry was a very good architect before he became very famous. He got famous because he was in the right place at the right time. He got the right client. So it's not, I think that every student sets out to be a Frank Gehry or Frank Lloyd Wright or that's like playing neighborhood basketball and saying you're going to be the next Michael Jordan. Somebody will be, but it requires a tremendous amount of talent, a tremendous amount of luck, and being in the right place at the right time. A tremendous amount of work. So there are ways to make sure that you set yourself up to play in that game, so to say, and that has a lot to do with where you choose to go to school. So if you want to work in Frank Gehry's office, there's like four schools in the world that he pulls his people from. Two of them happen to be in LA, so.
Wait,
is
that important?
USC and Sire?
Really? Those are the schools I want to graduate from.
What was the U.S. in with?
SIAR, Southern California Institute of Architecture. It's a small school.
They can hang out right outside, but the train tracks are nice.
So you can set yourself up to work in certain offices by going to certain schools and then proving, you know, your worth at those schools and getting internships with those firms. And, but even if you go work for Frank Gehry, 300 people work for him. Because then you're going to be the next Frank Gehry, right?
What's that?
Schumann? Bernard Schumann? Yeah. You might want to go to Columbia, then that's where he gets most of his support. So there is definitely star architects out there, and you can build your education around working for those star architects if that's the route that you want to take. And I tell you, I went to SIAR for part of my undergrad, and I have a post-professional degree from SIAR. It's a different world than here. How many of you think we've worked really hard this semester so far? Oh, good. I'm glad nobody has that illusion. What we've done here in the first 2 weeks, we would have done in 2 days at SIAR. It's just amazing that it moved up.
They have the resources, though. The whole school has the resources. The place is beautiful. It'd be a shame if you failed.
What does that have to do with how much time you can dedicate to the program? If I paint the walls here in a beautiful color, you're going to put more work into the class?
You know what? I was thinking about that. If I still kill, because I'm killing, I'm getting your education, your is from SIAR, and I'm getting it mad cheaper.
Yeah, she charged you more, absolutely.
Yeah.
So, in the readings that we did for homework, it was kind of obvious that different architecture schools have their own sort of emphasis, or, you know, some are more, I don't know, historic and or
absolutely.
Whatever.
Absolutely. Every school focuses on its own special.
What would you say you do in all the years? Just curious.
Young.
Yeah?
As an institution, it's young, right? So.
Yeah.
I don't know that UNLV has as much of a tradition as other schools have. Exactly. So I think UNLV is trying to figure out exactly what it wants to be. There's a big push for sustainability to be the focus. They competed in the Solar Decathlon. There's other people at the school that would like to see the school push in different directions. So I think UNLV is still a very young school and trying to decide exactly what it wants to be.
Okay.
Which is not necessarily a bad thing, because then you can kind of go there and make it what you want it to be. You know?
But I'm just curious. Yeah. Okay.
All right. Does this all make sense? We will revisit this again and again and again. Well, part of what you're going to accomplish throughout the course of the semester is what I call a five-year plan. But it's hard for you to develop a five-year plan if you don't have any idea what it takes, what's the next step. So by the end of the semester, you will have developed, and we'll talk about this in greater detail later, semester, you will have developed a five-year plan. What are you going to do next? You can stay here at CSN and finish your associates and go on and do something else, or are you going to transfer next semester to UNLV, or you? I'm not real particular about what you choose to do in the next 5 years of your life. I just want you to be well informed and be able to make those decisions based on good information. So where's the best place to get the information? At the source, right? If you want to know what it takes to get registered in, say, Nevada, you can either take my word for it or you can go look it up on their website. Now, I've visited that website, I don't know, 1,000 times maybe in my lifetime, but things change. Requirements change. So go right to the source. If you're transferring to another institution, go to the source and ask them, what are they going to require? I, of course, will try to point you in the best direction, but go to the source of the information always, whether you're doing research or whether you're trying to figure out what to do next, or you're trying to get the answer, go to the source. You got a question about NCIDQ? Don't ask somebody who took the exam 5 years ago. Go ask NCIDQ, because the person is going to tell you what their experience was 5 years ago, which may or may not be valid at this point. All right. Well, I think after that, you have a pretty good handle on what it's going to take for you to become registered in your respective fields. Would you agree? Hopefully, well, you should be starting to formulate as an opinion about this profession that you've chosen to be part of. How do I get from where I'm at right now, an introduction to architecture class, to registration if that's my goal, to becoming the next Frank Gehry, if that's my goal, to just getting my associate's degree, if that's my goal. And that's really for you to decide, right, what your goal is, and then we'll help you navigate how you can. Any other questions about this before we move on to the next item? So let's take a 5 minute break, stretch your legs, and get your sketchbooks out. We're going to talk about sketching a little bit. Yes, sir. Okay, sketching. Why would we ask you to sketch? Why do you think I asked you to get a sketchbook? Putting your ideas on paper, yeah, but that's not really the reason. Communication, right? So what is the purpose of your sketch? Are you all the next Van Goghs, Picassos, Renoirs?
No.
No, that's not the point. So the point is, how do I communicate an idea? So there's an example. I think there's an example of a pencil. I'll post a link to it. The file is already up on Canvas for you. This is an example of a pencil. And I have my sketch paper, something like this. There's a little title block underneath the sketch paper. And I ask you to draw a pencil. What should you do if you're drawing a pencil? Maybe look at a pencil, right? So if I look at this pencil, it has some characteristics that I'm trying to capture. All right, and one of those characteristics might be pretty straight lines, right? I might just want to draw some couple straight lines. Okay, kind of looks like my pencil, right? I might want to add a little bit of detail here at the end. We all agree that that's a pencil.
Yeah.
All right, and I might come in here and add even a little bit more detail. Still agree that that's a pencil, right?
Yeah.
And if I really want to get some more detail in there, I may, no, granted, I have a marker, it's not exactly the finest drawing tool. But I may add, a darker line down here at the bottom. Maybe that wasn't the greatest, but you gotta get my point, right? Pencil, you should be able to draw a better pencil. How long did that take? Not very long, right? So if I had more time, what would I continue to do?
Add more detail.
I would add more detail, right? I might like add a shadow here. I want to continue to add detail to it. Continue to add detail to it. Now, did I just say, hey, draw a pencil, and I just started drawing a pencil? What did I do first? I looked at it and I broke it down into its basic elements. How many of you can draw a line? You think? Maybe. That's all it is. A straight line. So we're going to do some exercises here in your sketchbook that are going to hopefully help you build a little bit of confidence. And teach you about the muscle motion in your lines. Were my three lines basically straight that I first drew? And how long do you think it took me to learn to just draw a straight line? Yeah, it took a little while, but it took a little bit of practice. So the first page of your sketchbook. You can follow along with me. I just want you draw straight lines. And what I want you to think about as you're drawing those straight lines is how you're holding your hand, speed at which you're pulling that pencil or pen across the paper. Just draw straight lines. So you fill up that whole sheet. Right? Generally, my lines are straight, right? They're not perfect, it's not a ruler. But that's your goal, draw some straight lines. Then the second page. Draw vertical lines. Again, paying attention to how you're holding your hand. If it's not straight, how can you adjust it to make it straight? Third page in your book. Draw a grid. When you draw the grid, try to make all these squares approximately the same size. That one's a little bit trickier. Fourth page in your book. You draw a zigzag line. When I want that series of zigzag lines, I want you to maintain space between them. Okay? Fifth page in your sketchbook. You draw a wavy line. Same thing, I want you to maintain that space between the lines. Next page, I want you to draw a spiral. Again, maintaining, he's trying to maintain the space. All right, if your pages look worse than mine and I'm using a marker, it means you've got a little bit of work to do. The whole page! I want a full page of all this. Don't stop where I stop you. Fourth page, I want you to draw squares that are evenly spaced. What are we doing here?
Wasting paper.
Wasting paper? No, we're not wasting paper. You're starting to train yourself, right? You're starting to understand. If you know that you're drawing lines like this here, and every one of your lines looks like this, what do you know you're doing? When I draw a straight line, I'm actually arcing it. You don't draw a straight line by holding your elbow straight and arcing back and forth. You're going to get a circle every time, right? If you're going to draw a straight line, you're going to have to actually think about how you pull that pencil across the page. Now, some of you may be natural artists and you don't have to think about this. But those of us that are not natural artists, how do you get better at something? You practice, and you break it into pieces that you can be successful at. If I said, draw a pencil, and you brought your pencil drawing back, and I was like, oh, that's a horrible pencil. Go draw it again. How would you know how to improve? All right, so see, you have an arc in every one of your lines.
I'm sorry?
You have an arc in every one of your lines. Look at it.
I know.
So you're not wasting paper because they're, how can I see it from there? You're not wasting paper, you're drawing an arc, so straighten your arc. No, put your eraser away. Don't worry about erasing things. You can't erase the past. You want those mistakes there so you can see how you're fixing them. So really concentrate on drawing a very straight line. When I first started teaching this class, I was just like, here's your sketchbook, start sketching. And we get like midway through the semester and people would bring their sketchbooks in and they were horrific.
Can we use the back of the page?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm all about being an environmentalist. They were horrific, and they were horrific because people didn't know how to get started, and they were intimidated by sketching, so they wouldn't do it. I want you to not be intimidated by sketching, but view it as a tool. Now, some people just are very talented and they just have talent. I don't have any talent when it comes to sketching. But I can draw a straight line. And I can put a series of straight lines or relatively straight lines together to start to communicate my ideas. That's all it is about, is communication. So if you, well, see, you're all over the place. So slow down and really think about keeping it at the same distance, right? So that's your guy. Being perfect. It's okay to have a mistake on your page. Several mistakes on your page.
Which, is like this or straight down?
This? Grid. I want you to draw a grid.
Like this?
No, that should be straight.
No, that should be straight.
Sorry. If you find yourself where you're just not having a lot of control over your hand, do some of these exercises. It will stop and make you think about, how do I have control over my hand? Eventually, anybody take the drafting class this semester, ADT 100? Hey, you're learning how to letter, right?
Yeah.
All right, eventually you'll be able to this will become second nature. I promise you.
Well,
what is this about?
Before you were writing a piece of paper, it looks like drafting.
You understood?
No, it's just you train your hand. This is actually really sloppy. When I first started lettering, first drafting class, I'll bring in some drawings. First drafting class, my instructor was like, wow, you're an excellent draftsman and your lettering is horrible. You know, it's so bad that the excellent drafting you do doesn't even make up for it. Yeah, he was really honest with me. I'll show you guys, it was really bad.
Real honesty.
And what I finally did is one day I said, fine, I'm going to stop writing in cursive altogether and I'm just going to letter. And for about the first 6 months, it was really, really painful. But after a while, I could train my hand. And I was able to get to where I could letter pretty well. This is the only way I write anymore. But I could letter well enough that I didn't have to use a lettering guide or anything on my drafting. Just do it. This is not a talent. This is just per will. I have no artistic talent when it comes to drawing in my body. But I know that I needed to be better at this so I can communicate clearly. So you just get used to it after a while. It's not about a race, right? So what do you see is happening here? So do it again.
Again?
Again. Practice. The only way you get there, right? Don't erase it. No. I want you to be able to look back at this and go, wow, look how much I've improved. These are the drawing exercises. I just want you to go through that. I'm going to walk around and lean over your shoulder, see how you're doing. And then, starting this week, there's going to be assignments up there for drawing, sketching. And it's going to give you a time limitation. And I want you to spend that amount of time on it. If the pencil says take 10 minutes to draw it, don't draw three lines and be like, I'm done with the pencil. I want you to think about, how much can I achieve in 10 minutes? If I say take 45 minutes to draw a room or something, please take the 45 minutes. Think about laying the room out, understanding scale, understanding shadow, really looking at what you're drawing, as opposed to drawing what you think it looks like. That's why it was so important that the first thing we did was look at a pencil as opposed to say, oh, I know what a pencil looks like, and then you start drawing. come on, Pablo, you're supposed to be like